क्या नाम है? स्पोर्ट्स
मेडिसिन में बोलते हैं।
हां जी मेडिसिन।
हां सबसे ऊपर था
मेडिसिन ऑफ डॉपिंग ना।
हां दिल्ली के पंजी अंदर के
नहीं नहीं वो ये स्किल जब इसका लाइन स्टार्ट कर रहे थे वो लाइन ही डाली थी।
अच्छा।
तो हाथ उधर से निकालने की कोशिश कर रहे थे पहले वो कौन है मुझे, लेकिन फिर वो वहीं से ऊपर ऊपर डाली है। देख लूँ लॉग इन किया है कि बैठ नहीं बैठ रहे जाना इधर से।
Morning everybody. The class that we have today is on sports medicine and doping. Now while doping is something that has been discussed many times, it's something of common knowledge, but sports medicine per se is an upcoming kind of a field, particularly in India. Of course it has been there for a long while, मतलब एवर सिंस द ओलंपिक्स एंड थिंग्स स्पोर्ट्स मेडिसिन हैज़ बीन अ पार्ट, बट द अटेंशन दैट इट डिजर्व्स इज नाउ बीइंग गिवन टू दिस पर्टिकुलर फील्ड। एंड द रीज़न इज ऑब्वियस दैट नाउ देर इज अ लॉट ऑफ फोकस ऑन प्रमोटिंग स्पोर्ट्स पर्टिकुलरली इन इंडिया। इंडिया हैज़ कम अप विद सो मेनी स्कीम्स फॉर नर्चरिंग द अपकमिंग स्पोर्ट्स पर्सन, and also more and more budgetary allocation is happening towards this particular field. So we'll now, why exactly do we need sports medicine? Now these are some of the figures which are from the US, but I don't have any Indian figures, but there's an estimated 30 to 45 million children between the age of 16 to 18 years who participate in some kind of sports annually. Nearly 3/4 of US households have at least one child that participates in organized sports. Sports participation is more accessible with increased variety, increasing sports specialization, more year-round and concurrent sports, and drive for success, college scholarships, going professional. So NCAA stats demonstrate that less than 0.5 to 1.6% of high school athletes will earn partial scholarships to D1 schools. 1% of college athletes go professional. Now as far as the Indian scenario is concerned, we know we have lot many sports. Of these, mostly we talk about cricket or maybe football or hockey, but besides that also there are sports, badminton, tennis, in which there is a lot of focus. And one of the reasons behind the focus is the same, like many households they consider that if the child, you know that it's very difficult to get admissions into good colleges without a good percentage or cracking some kind of an entrance exam. But in case of sports people, as far as universities are concerned, particularly Delhi University I know of, in Delhi University, if you have participated in any international event, matlab any level international event, which is recognized by some sports federation, then you automatically qualify for admission into a college of your choice. And if you are a sports person of national level or zonal level, interzonal level, then there are certain marks which are assigned to that particular level based on your certificates for the last couple of years. This time it was 3 years since May. So you are assigned certain marks, and based on that plus a trial. This time, of course, because of the COVID thing, there is going to be no trial, but based on a cumulative of the level at which you have played, the marks allotted on the basis of that and your sports trial, a merit list is drawn and you are eligible for admission to the best of colleges. When we talk about best of colleges, we are talking about the top institutes in the country. They have a sports quota everywhere. So this is what people normally aim for. And this thing doesn't stop here. If you continue sports or if you have been a participant in sport, then you are eligible for jobs in many places, like, you know, a lot of recruitment in the police services, CRPF, BSF, a lot of places. You get, there are specific seats which are reserved for sports people, and the reservation is not like just any sports person or anything, it's discipline wise. So normally people target that particular thing, and so that is why sports have gained a lot of popularity in India also. And then of course from a physical fitness point of view, so that is one of the reasons government is promoting sports, because even for sustainable development goals you need to be physically active, you need to be fit. So sports medicine is therefore going to be a huge field in the coming years. Now, World Health Organization and International Federation of Sports Medicine studies have shown that half of the world population is insufficiently active, which results in colossal waste of human potential, and it is also a major contributor to ill health and unnecessary inactive lifestyle. Elevators, escalators, motor cars, airplanes, televisions, leading to physical inactivity, resulting in weight gain, obesity, postural problems. So what we are talking of is not just sports on a professional level or for a certain kind of a professional gain, but physical fitness or sports is important from a point of view of health also. We know that there are studies which show that there is a relationship between the risk of a particular disease, like say diabetes or hypertension or strokes, which is related to the physical activity. So that is why a lot of people are, the older people, comparatively older people, are also taking up sports. Now, coming to the history of sports medicine, the origin of sports medicine lies in ancient Greece and Rome, where physical education was valued and an integral part of an adolescent's life. The care of athletes was done by specialists. These people were thought to have specific knowledge in diet, physical therapy, and sports-specific techniques. In the 2nd century AD, the first team doctor was Galen, who was appointed to the gladiators. So now we hear of doctors for all the teams. You have a physiotherapist, you have a psychologist. So, but the origin is from the gladiator time. This marked the beginning of practice of having a doctor involved all of the time, not just when an injury occurs. And it is obvious from this also that sports medicine is not like one single field, but it encompasses multiple disciplines. Like, you need the psychological health, you need physical fitness, you need a good diet. If there is an injury, you need a proper plan to attend to that injury, and then of course the rehabilitation part. So sports medicine is an umbrella term that includes all professionals concerned with enhancing the performance and healthcare of physically active individuals, be it for sports exercise or recreational activity, and it encompasses all phases of medical concerns relating to athletic activity. So what all would come under sports medicine is any kind of biomechanical thing, psychological, nutritional, environmental, pathological and physiological. So basically sports medicine is an umbrella term, and you see that a lot of people are involved, starting from the coach, the dentist, the physician, the kinesiologist, nutritionist, physical therapist, psychologist, trainer, orthopedic surgeons, exercise physiologist, ophthalmologist, chiropractor, podiatrist, emergency medical technician, nurse, athletic director, physical educator. I mean, all these people form the team which is really involved in sports medicine. Sports medicine is synonymous with exercise and fitness and is also known as fitness medicine. So sports medicine is basically an occupational medicine which is similar to industrial medicine, aviation medicine and military medicine. What sports medicine does is it applies medical and scientific knowledge in enhancing performance in sports and fitness related areas. It also prescribes sports and exercise as treatment modality for medical problems and thereby enhances the quality of life of common man. Now, sports medicine would include medical sciences input for spotting, nurturing and enhancing talent for sports, and sports and exercise input in the area of medical sciences, that is exercise prescription. So what all comes under sports medicine? Genetics, biomechanics, medicine, anthropometry, training methods, doping, physiology, nutrition, psychology, traumatology. Now, how genetics? Because we know that depending upon your genetic makeup, you may have some variations which, if we know from the beginning, then we can really decide that whether it would be worthwhile to follow a particular kind of a sport. This is one example, the angiotensin converting enzyme. It has two versions, the I version and D version. The I version enhances the uptake of nutrients and oxygen to muscles, and hence this is associated with better physical performance. Similarly, in muscle fibers you have fast twitch fibers, white fibers which are for speed and strength, and you have slow twitch fibers, red fibers, which are for endurance. So you know that sports would require endurance, speed, strength, accuracy. And then there is something called gene doping, which is an increase of a single gene. It has been shown that an increase in a single gene in mice caused increase in muscle size, increase in strength, increased ability to repair injuries. And this particular gene is IGF-1 gene, which is also found in humans. IGF-1, what does it do? It accelerates factor for muscle growth. Then there is myostatin, inhibitory factor for muscle growth. And you can use different antagonists which will cause alteration in muscle growth, and as of now there are no detection systems available for this. Then anthropometry, what it implies is that you do a body typing based on your body measurements like height, weight, fat, muscle mass, bone mass. This is also used for age determination. Like before any competition, one of the things that is done is the age determination, so that there is no foul play which is involved. So for that, you know, one of the things that they look at is the dentition, and then of course the secondary sexual characteristics, x-rays and MRI scans. Then exercise physiology, this would evaluate the motor abilities, endurance, speed, strength, agility, flexibility and coordination. The tests which are done in this is the VO2 max, oxygen deficit, lactate tolerance, lung function test, heart rate monitoring and muscle strength and endurance. So it is not like you actually have a tailor-made kind of a thing. The scenario would be that if somebody is committing himself, herself to a particular sport, it is not like that you sort of do it as, okay, if it works out, fine, if it doesn't work out, fine. If you really train for any particular kind of a sport, it requires a lot of hard work, you need to put in a lot of hours, and it doesn't make any sense that if you are not really cut out for that particular sport, that you should put those many hours in it, because there's no point in being a mediocre if you are planning to be a professional. So you have to be somewhere before you really think of working for a particular sport. So a lot of sports is not like anybody can just get up and go and say that today, okay, I'm going to be a swimmer today, or I'm going to be a gymnast today, or I'm going to be a tennis player today. Right. Then another field which is important is the sports psychology. Now, sports psychology is normally used to overcome the invisible and invincible barriers in sports, and this involves mental training, motivation, anticipation, reaction time, relaxation, and nurturing the killer instinct. Now, what happens is that all these athletes and all, they are training for a long, long period of time, and there are you normally, when you train, you are staying away from home, there is a lot of stress, then you see that your peers, they may be performing much better than you. Most people don't get to train individually, and even if you are training individually, then there's a lot of psychological pressure, because you are missing out on a lot in life if you are training for a particular sport. You're not going to socialize or anything, because all of your time would be involved with just working on that particular sport. Then there's a lot of peer pressure in the sense that you have your comparators, you have people who are training with you who are doing much better than you at times. Then it could be that you are at the top and then suddenly you have an injury which incapacitates you for a particular period of time. So during that time, the mental health has to be taken care of, and even the motivation, there are certain sports which would involve taking some risks. They're not exactly risks, they're calculated kind of things, but then if there is this fear factor that comes in, then that has to be taken care of. And most important, the time that you get between your practices, that has to be devoted to rest. So for that rest, you need to relax, because that mindset is very different when you are training for any particular kind of a sport. Then of course, nutrition. This is something which cannot be overlooked. So normally, depending upon the kind of sport, the kind of requirement that you have, and of course your anthropometric features, every athlete should have a diet which suits him, and it has to be a balanced diet, of course, and then it has to be basically tailor-made for that particular person, depending upon how that person is and what is the requirement. The requirement would be dependent upon the body type and dependent upon the sport, and then dependent upon whether he is in competition, he is out of competition. So you have a pre-competition meal, glycogen loading, you have food supplements, then whether you are vegetarian, non-vegetarian. So based on that, for each individual, the diet has to be designed. Then there are food supplements. Normally, most of the sports people are advised protein supplements to build up the muscle mass and all. So which supplement, which particular combination, so all that has to be really looked into. It's not like you just pick up anything from the market and start off with it. Then biomechanics and kinesiology. Now, what biomechanics and kinesiology involves is, it tries to monitor your movement. When you are into a particular sport, it tries to see that, and this is a very scientific kind of a discipline, in the sense that they'll do all kinds of measurements. They would record what you are doing. They play it in slow motion, calculate the angles and things, and then they try to correct that particular thing. So supposing while taking a jump, somebody is sort of, you know, bending the knee or something, particularly in a sport like gymnastic where each and every movement has a point. So whether you are keeping your legs straight, they are tight enough, the toes are turned out, or the hands are flexed, or the knee is bending, or whatever. So that has to be checked and corrected. Maybe you are doing the movement or you are doing the element perfectly, but then it would be there's still a likelihood that you may not score as many points. Even though you execute that particular element, you may not score the right points because you got the marks for the element, but you lose marks on the execution. So execution is equally important. And then there are certain sports like weightlifting and all, or hammer throw and all. In these cases, if you don't get your movements right, then you stand to injure yourself. Maybe, you know, because this one particular joint which is involved in these kind of sports. So getting the movement right is very important. And till now, in India at least, the trend has been, at least at the junior level or the national level, the trend has been that okay, the coach has told you do this and you do it that way. We don't really we have not really been into this scientific kind of thing that we analyze the movement and then try to correct it. Although in US and all they have all the facilities to do this, but here we don't quite do that. And that is probably one of the reasons that when we talk about competing in lot many sports at an international level, Olympics level, or even for Commonwealth Games and things, we don't score that well. In spite of putting in a lot of practice, in spite of having a lot of talent, you know, in such a huge country, there is no reason for any dearth of talent. The only problem that comes in is that this field of sports medicine is very poorly represented. So, right from nutrition to the training and how the corrections can be done, which is very manageable, that is not being done. So that is why there are problems. And then of course the psychology part. Again, when there is injury, rehabilitation is happening. So killing those 6 months or 1 year of being out of the sport and always agonizing over whether I would be able to make it back or not. So all this needs to be handled, which may be being done for say very senior level or top level kind of a sports person, but for general children who are training, this is not being done. And if we really see, then most of the Olympic medalists and all, they've had training from outside. Their training has also been outsourced at times. So probably that's one of the reasons that they have been able to do so well. Sorry. Then of course sports traumatology, sports injuries go hand in hand. So sorry. So sports injuries is part and parcel of training. So you have to make sure, the first is of course prevention, which may not be possible. Once that is not possible, then the management and rehabilitation. So when we are talking of prevention, what we talk about is that there should be proper safeguards in place so that injury doesn't happen in one place at all. But if it does, then management. Now when we talk about management, the injury would not be happening at home, it would be happening during active practice. So when the injury is actually happening, then has happened, then at the place of practice there should be sufficient infrastructure to manage it. Like you know, if it's supposing just a sprain or something, then the coach or the physiotherapist if he's available there. They should know that the child has to be, or the person, that sports person has to be immobilized, or icing has to be done, or whatever management thing is to be required. Or supposing there is a risk of a serious injury, like some kind of a spinal cord injury or something, some back injury, then the sports person that we is not to be moved at all till you get him to a facility for management. Then again, management would involve multidisciplinary kind of a thing. It may involve a surgery, it may be just physiotherapy, it could be some orthopedic, other orthopedic manipulation. And then comes the rehabilitation part. So rehabilitation part is that, say your leg is in a plaster and the plaster has been removed, but after that it is not like, you know, you just go back to the injury. You need to get your muscles and the joints into the position to go back to your sport. So you would require some kind of a strengthening exercise or something. The most commonly seen sporting injuries in general practice are muscle and soft tissue tears and strains, epicondylitis, interior knee pains, calf and ischial pain, stress fractures, ankle sprains, foot pain, back pain. And what does the rehabilitation aim to restore? Range and flexibility of movement and power. Joints must have a full and painless range of movement before competitive sport is restarted. Then there is the case of medical problems which may be already pre-existing. Normally if there is a pre-existing issue, people don't take to sports. But there may be something which may go undetected at times. So these problems could relate to cardiology, respiratory medicine or endocrinology. Now this, particularly in females, the endocrinological issues during sporting events do occur. So basically these days any kind of injury, traumatic injury or say a fracture or anything, it does not put an end to the career if it is managed properly. Now we come to the next part of the class, that is doping. Now this is something you must be very familiar with. Now doping, you know that it's basically addition of any kind of drug or agent to enhance the performance. Okay, so when we talk about enhancing the performance, it could be to increase the muscle mass, like steroids and all are used, or to increase the accuracy, like beta blockers to stop tremor or something, you know, which is given in addition, which would give you an undue benefit over your competitor. So that would come, that particular thing would come under the doping part. And we know that there are lists now, a lot of prohibited substances and methods. WADA is the agency which is basically involved with doping. This is World Anti-Doping Agency. And we have NADA. So for a substance or method to be added to the list, it must be determined that it meets at least two of the following three criteria. Now these are the prohibited substances and methods. Prohibited means not to be used at all. It has the potential to enhance or it has the potential to enhance or enhances sports performance. It represents an actual or potential health risk to the athletes. It violates the spirit of sport. Okay, so if any substance meets any two of these criteria, then it is strictly banned. It's totally prohibited. Now, history of doping. Doping has been there since 3rd century BC. All these gladiators and Greek Olympic athletes, they used to use stimulants such as brandy, wine, hallucinogenic mushrooms. In the 1904 Olympics marathon, Thomas Hicks was administered 2 injections of sulfate of strychnine by his trainer during the race. You know, it's a CNS stimulant, strychnine. And then amphetamine was in use during World War II, and amphetamine was found to be one of the major things which was used by athletes also. So in the 1950s, Soviet Olympic team experimented with testosterone supplements to increase strength and power. The first doping related death in Olympics happened in 1960 when Danish cyclist collapsed during the 100 km team time trial at the Rome Olympics and later died in the hospital. He had taken amphetamine and he had a cardiac arrest basically. Then steroid use became very popular by the 1964 Olympic Games, and it was seen that there was a startling improvement in many strength athletes. Soon steroids were being extensively used by athletes in all strength sports. The doping controls was first introduced in 1968 by the International Olympic Committee at both Summer and Winter Olympics, and anabolic steroids were banned in 1976 after a label test was developed. The first televised doping related death was that of Tom Simpson, who collapsed during the Tour de France, and the autopsy revealed levels of methamphetamine in his system. In 1980 Moscow Summer Olympics, no athletes were caught doping at the 1980 Summer Olympics. 20% of the specimens he tested, included those from 16 gold medalists, would have resulted in disciplinary proceedings had the test been official. Then in 1988 Olympics men's 100 meter final, Johnson was stripped of his gold medal by the IOC after he tested positive for stenozolol. Maradona, you all have heard about. In 1991, he tested positive for cocaine. Lance Armstrong, there are a couple of movies on him also. He was again a cyclist, and in 2012, he was stripped of his title. He had used agents like erythropoietin and testosterone. Marion Jones, Shane Warne, Maria Sharapova, and closer at home we had Narsingh Yadav, Indian wrestler who tested positive for methendienone and was banned for 4 years. Prithvi Shaw, Indian cricketer, was handed an 8-month ban after testing positive for terbutaline. And most important, WADA banned Russia from major international sporting events for 4 years on charges of tampering with doping related reports. Now when we talk about doping and the kind of substances which cannot be used by the athletes, we classify them into 3 categories. These are prohibited at all times, prohibited in competition, prohibited in particular sports. Now, substances prohibited at all times are all non-approved substances, anabolic agents, peptide hormones, growth factors, related substances and mimetics, beta 2 agonists, hormone and metabolic modulators, diuretics and masking agents. Now, what are non-approved substances? These are any pharmacological substances with no current approval by any governmental regulatory health authority for human therapeutic use. And these are drugs under preclinical or clinical development, designer drugs, substances approved only for veterinary use. Then we have anabolic steroids. These are the anabolic androgenic steroids. When administered exogenously and other substances with a similar chemical structure or similar biological effects. These include androstenediol, androstenedione, bolesterone, danazol, gestrinone, nandrolone, stenozolol, testosterone. And there is the others category in which you have clenbuterol and SARMs. Then we have peptide hormones, growth factors, related substances and These include erythropoietin and agents affecting erythropoiesis, erythropoietin receptor agonists, hypoxia inducible factor, GATA inhibitors, TGF-beta signaling inhibitors, and include things like darbepoetins, erythropoietin, cobalt, daprodustat, molidustat, roxadustat, there are some numbered compounds, then luspatercept, sotatercept. Then there are peptide hormones and their releasing factors, chorionic gonadotropic and luteinizing hormone and their releasing factors, corticotropins and their releasing factors, and growth hormones and its fragments and releasing factors. These include substances like bucerelin, gycerelin, leporelin, nephrelin, corticorelin, somorelin, and tesmorelin. Then lenomorelin, enomorelin. Mostly you will see they are either GnRH agonists or related to some growth hormone releasing peptides. Then there are the beta 2 agonists. All selective and non-selective beta 2 agonists, including all optical isomers except inhaled salbutamol, which can be there up to 1600 microgram over 24 hours in divided doses, not to exceed 800 micrograms over 12 hours starting from any dose. Then inhaled formoterol, maximum delivered dose of 54 micrograms over 24 hours, and inhaled salmeterol, maximum 200 micrograms over 24 hours. The prohibited ones are phenoterol, formoterol, indecterol, olodeterol, salbutamol, salmeterol, terbutalin, and velanterol. Then we have hormone and metabolic modulators. These include the aromatase inhibitors, anastrozole and letrozole, selective estrogen receptor modulators, the SERMs, bezidoxin, raloxifene and tamoxifen. Then other anti-estrogenic substances like clomiphene and fluvistatin. Then agents preventing activin receptor activation like bimagrumab, follistatin, myostatin binding proteins, follistatin, myostatin propeptide, myostatin neutralizing antibodies, domagrozumab, landogrozumab, and activators of AMP activated protein kinases. Then we have diuretics and masking agents. Diuretics and masking agents are prohibited, as are other substances with a similar chemical structure or similar biological effects, except drospirenone, pemabrom, and ophthalmic use of carbonic anhydrase inhibitors like dorzolamide and brinzolamide, local administration of felipresin in dental anesthesia. The prohibited substances are desmopressin, probenecid, plasma expanders, albumin dextran, mannitol and hydroxyethyl starch, acetazolamide, amiloride, bumetanide, canrinone, chlorotelidone, ethocyanic acid, furosemide, indapamide, metolazone, spironolactone, and thiazides. Now we'll just take up the major categories. Among the anabolic agents, why they are used is to increase the muscle mass, aid recovery, and increase red cell mass and hematocrit. And we know we have androstenediol, androstenedione, bolacetrazone, danazol, and these are some of the things which are used: gestrinone, mestinolone, nendrolone, stenozolol, testosterone, trenbolone. What are the adverse effects with these compounds? Dyslipidemia, hyperinsulinemia, endothelial dysfunction, thrombosis, cardiomyopathy, cholestatic jaundice, pilosis, hepatitis, hepatocellular adenoma. And in specifically males, it can cause impotence, testicular prostate atrophy, gynecomastia, and prostatic hypertrophy. In females, menstrual abnormalities and virilization. So basically, these are the mechanisms of ergogenic effects of anabolic steroids. It acts via the androgen receptors, which increases testosterone, induces muscle growth, vasodilation, increases capillary density within skeletal muscle, and increases erythropoiesis. Estradiol and dihydrotestosterone would also act on androgen receptor. Then there is something called designer steroids, which are manufactured specifically to circumvent doping tests in sport, and they are supplied in a clandestine fashion. There is something called a German Democratic Republic doping program. Since 1983, a pharmaceutical company had produced preparations of epitestosterone propionate exclusively for the governmental doping programs. So basically, the sports have become so competitive that the governments are sponsoring these kind of activities. That's the same thing which happened in Russia. Then there was this Balco investigation, a transdermal preparation coded as the cream containing testosterone and epitestosterone, a sublingual preparation of a new anabolic steroid coded as the clear, which contained tetrahydrogestrinone. THG was invisible on the routine GCMS screen employed by the WADA labs and necessitated the development of LCMS screen for its detection. Then coming to the peptide hormones, growth factors, related substances and mimetics. The most important is the erythropoietin. We know the site of synthesis is renal cortex, and critical parameter for EPO synthesis is tissue oxygen tension, and it increases erythropoiesis and thereby increases the oxygen carrying capacity of the blood. So what are the adverse effects that you see with the use of this particular compound? Increased viscosity of blood, hypertension, myocardial infarction, stroke, pulmonary embolism. And what are the agents which would affect erythropoiesis? Erythropoietin receptor agonists, hypoxia-inducible factor activating agents, GATA inhibitors, TGF-beta signaling inhibitors, and innate repair receptor agonists. Then we have the chorionic, gonadotropin and luteinizing hormones. XCG binds to the LH receptor and stimulates the Leydig cells to secrete testosterone. A single intramuscular injection of 6,000 international units of chorionic gonadotropin increases testosterone levels by approximately 40 nanomoles per liter in healthy men. No indication that the effects in females can positively influence performance. Then corticotropins and their releasing factors. In response to cortisol, free fatty acids are released, potentially sparing glycogen, which is then assumed to benefit endurance performance. Then growth hormone, it promotes amino acid uptake and protein synthesis in muscles, and the adverse events which can occur with growth hormone are insulin resistance, hyperglycemia, hypertension, sodium retention, cardiomegaly, acromegaly, premature epiphyseal closure. Then insulin like growth factor 1, it promotes amino acid uptake and protein synthesis in muscles. And the adverse events which can occur are hypoglycemia, arrhythmias, cardiomyopathy, osteoarthritis, and increased risk of prostate cancer. Growth factors and growth factor modulators. Blood platelets can release growth factors, for example, when triggered by signs of injury, potentially be used for treating sports injury. Most of these factors, including fibroblast, hepatocyte, mechano, platelet-derived and vascular endothelial growth factors and thymosine beta 4. There are no studies regarding the effects on performance, but still they have been used. Then of course the beta 2 agonists. Some studies indicate that they could benefit endurance performance and cycling sprint power. High-dose systemic beta 2 agonists have a positive effect on muscle strength and peak sprint power. Oral beta 2 agonist combined with resistance training could improve strength. Majority of evidence shows no ergogenic effects of inhaled beta 2 agonists. Then we have hormone and metabolic modulators. These include the aromatase inhibitors. Aromatase inhibitors reduce enzyme activity for the conversion of androgens to estrogens, leads to lowered estrogen levels, and thereby via inhibition of negative feedback on the hypothalamus to higher testosterone levels, increases approximately 15 nanomoles per liter in healthy males. No trials investigating the effects of aromatase inhibitors on performance, and the only indication of potential effects is a moderate increase in testosterone. then the Serbs. They are used for their estrogenic and anti-estrogenic effects in different tissues, induces increase in pituitary gonadotropin secretion and consequently increases in testosterone levels in men. No study is investigating the effect of SERMs on performance. Then the myostatin inhibitors. Myostatin is the growth differentiation factor rate. It is a negative regulator of muscle growth. Lowering its levels or inhibition of its action could potentially increase muscle size and improve performance. Agents preventing activin receptor 2B activation. Myostatin binds activin type 2 receptors more strongly than to R2B and to 2A. Role for activin type 2 receptors in the myostatin signaling pathway, and most drugs under clinical development are targeting this particular pathway. Then there are insulins and insulin mimetics. In addition to their hypoglycemic properties, insulins have an anabolic action which makes them potential doping agents for increasing muscle mass. Insulin increases the rate of glucose uptake into the muscles, aid recovery by facilitating muscle glycogen replenishment. Then AMP activated protein kinase activators. They augment the adaptations to endurance training, such as the enhancement of mitochondrial biogenesis, angiogenesis, and insulin sensitivity. The overall outcome is muscle fibers with a greater aerobic capacity and greater fatigue resistance. Then we have meldonium, a carnitine analog that inhibits formation of L-carnitine, which ultimately reduces fatty acid transport into mitochondria. With less fatty acid available to serve as the substrate for energy production, more carbohydrate is used. Reduces oxygen consumption through enhanced glycolysis, may translate into improved performance and recovery for endurance athletes. Sharpova was caught with meldonium. Trimetazidine, it inhibits the beta oxidation of free fatty acids, thereby increasing the use of carbohydrates as a substrate for energy production, which requires less oxygen. May improve performance among endurance athletes. Then diuretics and masking agents. Athletes use diuretics to increase urine output in order to dilute banned drugs. Diuretics are also used to reduce the fluid retention that can accompany use of androgenic anabolic steroids. The adverse effects are dehydration, electrolyte disturbances. Then desmopressin is used again for hemodilution, reduction in plasma concentrations of hemoglobin and other blood parameters, used to mask the use of RuEPO and to modify the hematological factors used in the WADA athlete biological passport program. Then probenecid, it blocks excretion of a number of drugs including anabolic steroids and their metabolites, results in more dilute urine with a lower concentration of the prohibited drugs. Plasma expenders, high molecular weight, biologically inert substances like glycerol, mannitol, dextrose, exert an osmotic effect, increase blood volume and dilute hematologic measurements, mask the administration of erythropoietin or erythropoietin-like substances. Now, methods prohibited at all times in and out of competition, we have the M1, manipulation of blood and blood components, administration or reintroduction of any quantity of autologous, allogenic or heterologous blood or red blood cell products of any origin into the circulatory system, artificially enhancing the uptake, transport or delivery of oxygen, perfluorochemicals, efavirenz and modified hemoglobin products, any form of intravascular manipulation of the blood or blood components by physical or chemical means. The M2 category has chemical and physical manipulation, tampering or attempting to tamper to alter the integrity and validity of samples collected during doping control, intravenous infusions and or injections of more than a total of 100 ml per 12-hour period, except for those legitimately received in the course of hospital treatments, surgical procedures or clinical diagnostic investigations. Then M3 takes into consideration the gene and cell doping, the use of nucleic acids or nucleic acid analogs that may alter genome sequences and or alter gene expression by any mechanism. This includes but is not limited to gene editing, gene silencing and gene transfer technologies, the use of normal or genetically modified cells. Then there is something called athlete biological passport. You may be aware of it. The principle is to monitor selected biological variables over time that indirectly reveal the effects of doping. They are based on individual and longitudinal monitoring of blood and urine markers. There are two modules, the hematological module and the steroidal module. So basically you do keep on repeating all these tests which come under the hematological module and the steroidal module, and any variation would be an indication that something is amiss. And then we have substances and methods which are prohibited in competition. These are stimulants, narcotics, cannabinoids and glucocorticoids. Stimulants include ephedrine, epinephrine, methylephedrine, methylphenidate, phenylethylamine and its derivatives, pseudoephedrine, selegiline, sibutramine, strychnine. Then of course you have cocaine, modafinil, and then all the morphine related compounds, buprenorphine, dimorphine, fentanyl, morphine, nicomorphine and oxycodone. There are cannabinoids and glucocorticoids. Just one moment, there is sparking happening. Let me call the attendant. Then we have cannabinoids. All natural and synthetic cannabinoids are prohibited. Cannabis and cannabis products, natural and synthetic. Sparks दिख रहे हैं। Synthetic cannabinoids that mimic the effects of THC like cannabidiol. Then we have glucocorticoids. All glucocorticoids are prohibited when administered by oral, intravenous, intramuscular or rectal routes. So basically all of them, betamethasone, budesonide, cortisone, deflazacort, dexamethasone, fluticasone, hydrocortisone, methylprednisolone, prednisolone, prednisone, triamcinolone. Then stimulants, they act by diminishing feelings of fatigue, accelerating reaction time, improving concentration and working memory, increasing alertness, increasing appetite and accelerating weight loss and improving endurance. And adverse effects we know: insomnia, anxiety, tremor, panic attacks, hypertension, tachycardia, myocardial infarction, stroke, aggressive behavior and psychosis, heat stroke. And amphetamines are used by athletes to increase alertness and concentration. Methylphenidate, dimethylamine, oxaliplatin. Ephedra alkaloids to improve alertness, accelerate weight loss, endurance and strength. Narcotics are strong analgesics, increase pain threshold. Tramadol is not prohibited. Adverse effects: dependence, nausea and vomiting, constipation, impaired coordination, decreased concentration and fatigue. Then cannabinoids, they are used to reduce anxiety, leads to decreased ability to concentrate and maintain attention, impair information processing and reaction time. The adverse effects: reduced alertness, impaired short-term memory, psychomotor retardation, dysphoria, paranoia and psychosis. Then glucocorticoids possess anti-inflammatory and analgesic properties after alter glucose metabolism, improve muscle strength. Adverse effects we know: hypoglycemia, fluid retention and acute mood changes. In chronic use, suppress the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis and lead to reduced muscle mass and weakness, osteoporosis, diabetes, hypertension, weight gain, abdominal obesity, cataracts and various psychiatric symptoms. Then we come to substances prohibited in particular sports. Now beta blockers, they are prohibited in archery, automobiles, billiards, darts, golf, shooting, skiing, snowboarding, in ski jumping, freestyle, half pipe and underwater sports. You know which are the beta blockers. What beta blockers actually do is reduce heart rate, anxiety and tremors, potentially enhance performance in sports where precision and accuracy are vital, may be counterproductive in endurance sports as they reduce maximum heart rate and increase stroke volume, reduce gluconeogenesis in skeletal muscle and restrict muscle blood flow. So this is just a summary. Anabolic steroids, muscle strength and power augmented with strength training. Then you know, World Anti-Doping Agency, WADA, a foundation created through a collective initiative led by the IOC, set up in 1999, and its governing bodies are composed in equal parts by representatives from the sporting movement and governments of the world. We are not interested in budgetary requirement right now. Key activities include scientific research, education, development of anti-doping capacities and monitoring of the World Anti-Doping Code. And in India, we have NADA, National Anti-Doping Agency, under the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports, Government of India, set up in 2005 with a mandate for dope-free sports in India. The primary objectives are to implement anti-doping rules as per WADA code, regulate dope control program, to promote education and research, creating awareness about doping and its ill effects. Now, since we have this background, so definition of doping and anti-doping rule violations. So this is presence of a prohibited substance or its metabolites or markers in an athlete's sample. Use or attempted use by an athlete of a prohibited substance or a prohibited method, evading, refusing or failing to submit to sample collection, any combination of three missed tests and or filing failures within a 12-month period by an athlete, tampering or attempted tampering with any part of doping control. Possession of a prohibited substance or a prohibited method, trafficking or attempted trafficking in any prohibited substance or prohibited method, administration or attempted administration to any athlete any prohibited substance or prohibited method, assisting, encouraging, aiding, abetting, conspiring, covering up or any other type of intentional complicity involving an anti-doping rule violation, and any prohibited association. Now, what are the so basically the lists that we saw, they were so exhaustive, there's hardly any drug which has been left out. But there are therapeutic use consumption exemption protocols in place. So criteria for a therapeutic use exemption as defined by WADA are as follows. The prohibited substance or method is needed to treat an acute or chronic medical condition such that the athlete would suffer a significant impairment to their health if the substance or method were withheld. The therapeutic use of the prohibited substance or method is highly unlikely to produce any additional enhancement of performance beyond what might be anticipated by a return to the athlete's normal state of health post-treatment. There is no reasonable therapeutic alternative to the prohibited substance or method. So basically, yesterday before finalizing this, I just ran it through, I sent it to somebody who had, NADA is now organizing a lot of programs in which they train athletes in doping, and they talk about doping, they tell them about this, and there are workshops which are held on this. So I had just run through my presentation by an athlete, and what she sent me back was that there have been instances here in India wherein medals for even national level events have been taken back, like the Khelo India thing. There was somebody who was stripped of that particular medal, of his gold medal, because on blood testing there were something which was found. And the reason for that particular thing being there in his blood was that he was taking some protein supplements. So even the protein supplements which are taken, they are to be taken with care, and it has to be ensured that they do not contain any added substances. एंड ऑल्सो देर वॉज इन सम ट्रायल्स फॉर सिलेक्शन देर वॉज एन इंसिडेंस वेन अपेरेंटली समबडी हैड इवन टेकन अ पैरासिटामोल एंड दैट ऑल्सो केम आउट और समथिंग लाइक दैट सो इवन दीज काइंड ऑफ थिंग्स डू हैपन सो एनीथिंग एंड एवरीथिंग हैज़ टू बी टेकन विद कॉशन बाई स्पोर्ट्स पीपल सो दैट्स ऑल अबाउट स्पोर्ट्स मेडिसिन एंड डॉक्टर हो गया जी। ये कितने विंडोज बंद करने पड़ते हैं?
आप कुछ मत करना, अपना पैनल खींच लीजिए।
अच्छा, इसको एग्जिट नहीं करना होगा?
वो मैं कर लूँगा।
ये बहुत बुरे से स्पार्क किया है और वहाँ से किया है, यहाँ से नहीं किया है।
तो गया था आपके साथ? कभी गया था?
अभी गया हुआ है।
हाँ, तो इधर कभी गया था?
वो
करा लूंगा, लेकिन लाइट होता है तभी। हाँ जी,
thank you.